Transitioning. I'm gonna turn his audio up.
Ladies and gentlemen, the man of the hour. This is Jaicko Lawrence. What's going on, brother?
Nice to meet you guys, man. How's everybody doing?
We're doing good, man. We're blessed, happy man. We are blessed to be talking to you. Yes, happy new year to you as well.
Yeah.
How's the levels, the volume levels in the Twitch chat? Somebody let me know if you can hear us good, if you can hear him.
Yeah.
That way we can get it rolling.
Let us know.
Yeah, we got somebody live. Somebody in the comments was like, hey, much love from Barbados, and they don't even know that that's where this man is right now. They could be living next door to you.
Yeah.
Barbados is a small place, so they probably are living next door to me.
Probably seeing you at the grocery. Don't even know. It's a legend right there.
Yeah. Can we move our screen a little bit? Yeah. Oh, there you go. Even better. There we go.
Okay. So, yeah, man. So just to give y'all some context as a viewer, we did an interview with Droid, who produced NCT 127's Focus.
Mm-hmm.
And he gave us a sneak peek, man. I don't know if he was allowed to or not, but we heard the demo version.
Ooh.
That Jaicko Lawrence was singing on. What you wanna do? And I was like, hold on, wait. Let me get that MP3.
Oh yeah.
And, you know, for reasons, he just didn't send me the MP3. So, okay. You know, by the end of this interview, I'm hoping that this guy could give me the MP3 to NCT 127's Focus. You know, the demo version. But aside from that, man, you are an amazing artist and songwriter. Mm-hmm. We've been playing your music, Rizzle Minded, your new latest album. We've been bumping that today.
Make sure y'all check that out.
Yeah,
I'm telling
man.
Y'all.
We'll leave a link to y'all, you know, in the it's already on our website, but we'll put it in the description, man. Just give us some background, man, on your story as an artist, man. I saw that we are like roughly the same age. So, and I saw that early in your career, you signed to Capitol Records, and then, you know, just fill us in, man.
Yeah.
Oh man, I probably should have just brought my book.
Yeah.
I don't actually have a book, but I at this point I should probably have one.
Yeah.
So me as an artist or musician, my journey as an artist started when I was born, really. I was born into a musical family. My dad being a boss musician himself, he plays the bass guitar. He formed several bands and stuff like that in Barbados, and then ended up touring around the Caribbean and then touring around the world. And so I kind of just grew up around that musical environment. And just like any, you know, son, you know, looking up to their dad, I kind of just caught fire, you know? And, you know, ever since I was a kid, I was singing, you know, playing drums, playing piano. And then when I was 9, I was a huge fan of then Lil Bow Wow. And, yeah. You know, cause he was like, in my time, he was the first kid star.
Yeah.
So for me, I was like, yo, this really proved that this was something that I could do. Mm-hmm. So by watching him, I began to emulate him. I started to learn all his raps, and my dad actually caught wind of me doing it. And he was like, yo, we need to get you in the studio. So by then, like I said, I was already familiar with, you know, music and stuff like that. So to get me in the studio was just like another level up. So I did my first like recording session here when I was 9 years old. And then it kind of became like, okay, we're starting to see that this thing could become a thing. And yeah. From then is when I began to, you know, just shape. I was molded by my dad and, you know, by my mother really to, you know, take that further. Then by the time I was 11 years old, I was traveling from Barbados to the US and meeting with different label executives and stuff like that. And so ever since then, I've been in it. And then, you know, so by the time I hit 16, 17 years old, ended up signing to Capitol Records, where we released my first major project. My first single was featuring Snoop Dogg, and we toured the US and parts of the globe with that. And, you know, then I went on to, you know, developing this love for writing music and just kind of doing my own thing. By the way, a lot of these songs that I've written on my first album, were actually written and produced by myself and my father, which was one of the things that got me the record deal. So then I was like, yo, now I'm in it. Now let me try to see how I can take it further as a producer, as a, you know, as a songwriter. So then I just began to develop that. And ever since then, I've been honing all of the skills, you know? Yeah. So that's, I guess throughout our conversation, we'll pick apart various parts. But, yeah, you know, exactly. It's kind of been, yeah, man.
That's a really compelling story, man. I myself was into the whole little Bow Wow when he first came out, man. That bounce with me, bounce with me. You couldn't catch me not doing that dance when little Bow Wow came on.
I wanted the cornrows. I wanted to be a dog. I was in it. And coincidentally, what was so funny about it was that my first single that came out on Capitol, I actually got like featuring Snoop Dogg. So that made it all the more cool, you know?
Talk about that experience. Did you ever get to perform the song with him or get a chance to meet Snoop or do you have a relationship with him at all?
So it's funny. I never met Snoop, never got a chance to perform the song with him.
Yeah.
Just at the time, it was one of those things that we were signed to the same label. And, you know, I think the label felt that it was, you know, would give the song good momentum to have a artist like Snoop jump on the record. And I didn't oppose to it, you know, so... Mm-hmm. It was good to call it what it was, though, you know? Definitely gave my record some more legs.
Yeah, that's dope. That's dope.
And for any parents out there, I mean, what he said is super compelling. You know, the support from his dad, you know, that's big. That's major. And I got a question. Did you ever happen to do any records with your dad?
So that's what I was saying. So you mean like him and I singing on the same record?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Never done like a full-on song, but... all of the writing and all of my producing and stuff early on, we wrote and produced all these songs together. He's an amazing producer as well.
Okay. So
we've always kind of written together and stuff like that, but never our same voices on a song, unless it was maybe background vocals or something like that.
Yeah.
But that's a good idea. Maybe we need to do it now.
Yeah, man, for sure, man. My pops was similar to your pops in his background. He's, from he's Panamanian and in Panama he was in a band and he toured around when he was young but I wasn't as fortunate enough to get into music at an early age, you know. I'm trying to get in it now, you know, that I'm old, you know. I'm old in terms of entertainment years.
Oh yeah.
but in life I'm actually young and thriving in my
That's
opinion.
Actually
yeah,
years,
mm-hmm.
doesn't matter.
No, I appreciate that. But what was it like early being an artist and signed and having that momentum and touring and everything? Talk to us a little bit about that experience, man. And was that like your first time like in the United States, like around that time, or how did that work out?
Right. So I had actually lived in the U.S. prior to that.
Yeah.
With my mom and my stepfather. I lived in the U.S. I went to school in the U.S. But by the time I had gotten signed, apart from living in the U.S., I had been traveling back and forth from Barbados to New York and Barbados to Miami. You know, thankfully. I'd been in offices. I probably at that time I got signed, might have seen every record executive. You know, I might have seen every label. So I was really being seasoned, you know. But you know, being seasoned and then actually cooking is two different things, right? I actually got in it, it was a whole new experience, but something that thankfully I'd been preparing for. And you know, at that time it really was a dream come true, you know. I'd been ready to get on the court, you know. So
yeah, gotta stay ready out here.
Ready out here, bro.
Yeah,
that's amazing. So how, all right, so more, some of your recent work, I don't want to skip anything.
Mm-hmm.
It's all good. I'll pull us
back. Okay.
So I saw that one of your, a big artist that you got a chance to work with was Akon.
Mm-hmm.
Tell me a little bit about that experience and how that came about.
Yeah, so during the time where I really had a desire to develop as a songwriter, And, you know, mentored by actually one of my good friends now, a guy by the name of August Rigo. He's written for like Chris Brown. He's actually done a ton of K-pop stuff as well. After, you know, sitting under his mentorship, I then went on to form my own little songwriting duo, you know, myself and my partner, Dimitri James out of Toronto, Canada. We formed a group called Formula 51. And we would just write songs on Skype, you know, all the time. And then we ended up getting invited to a writing camp in Greece. And this writing camp was for a huge DJ out in Europe by the name of DJ Antoine. So we were at the camp and we had written that song for, I think when we did it for like Sean Paul or something like that. And it ended up going to Akon, and you know, that was a big breakthrough moment for us as well, because that was, I think that was like one of the first major artists that we had written for.
Nice, nice, man. What track was that?
It's a song called Holiday.
Okay. Yeah. Holiday. I'm a fan of Akon, man. Yeah, man. When he came out with that song with Young Jeezy, man. I'm locked up.
Won't let me out.
Yeah, man.
That was a big record, man.
Yeah, that was big, man. That was huge.
That was a big tune.
Yeah.
Nice, man. So how has that been transitioning from a young, thriving artist in the limelight into now more of a songwriter? Correct me if I'm wrong, but I don't know what you kind of do mostly now. But
Right. Yeah.
Talk about that transition and what it's been like for you.
Yeah, I would say at certain points in my career, just as a musician, if you want to call it that, it was kind of hard to balance both, obviously, because when you're in an industry that's very much about, you know, putting all of your eggs in one basket, you know, at least to get on, it had become hard for me to kind of see myself as all of these things. Because if you're an artist, the idea is like, okay, you blow up as an artist and then you kind of focus on something else, you know?
Yeah.
I think at one point in my career, I think I'd probably given up as an artist, you know, after my whole thing with Capital, not really being able to find my place, you know? So songwriting became kind of like my resort. Thankfully, my resort ended up making me, you know, giving me a little bit of success. And, you know, in more recent times, you know, having discovered myself, I kind of just am all of those things now, you know. So I put just as much effort into me being a songwriter as me being an artist. Hence why, you know, we're able to talk about my latest project, Rizzle Minded, which was really born out of, you know, my testimony, you know, me coming to know who I am. And then now me being able to filter that through all the music that I do. So, you know, I would say at first it was a bit hard to kind of balance these things, but now I kind of do it. I'm grateful to say that I've kind of found my way in being able to put just as much effort into all of the things that I do musically. And I feel blessed to be able to do so many things musically, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, man.
Does that answer your question?
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely, man. That was a great answer.
Mm-hmm. I got a question. So it seems like, you know, it could be a lot of work doing what you do. Can you take me through like a day in the life of someone who's a songwriter? Like, do you write all day? Do you write a certain portion of the day? And do you get some feedback? Like, what's it look like?
So I'd be honest with you, I had to put this thing in its place, right? I had to take myself away from that, because I found the more I did that, the more it became a chore, the more I stopped loving it, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So now I tend to prioritize things that influence my freedom in life, so that when I come to that place, when I get in the studio, I'm so free that the creative process, it doesn't matter what I'm doing it for, you know?
Yeah.
So it's definitely a staple in my life. It's definitely something that I acknowledge as something that I have to do every day or almost every day. I definitely do see it as a job, but you know, I kind of give myself the time to do other things, you know, things that fuel that passion and fuel that drive for making music. So I want it to remain something that I love to do for all of my life, whether I'm making millions of dollars, whether I'm not making any money from it at all, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah. That's good. So day to day, I try my best to get in here every day. You know, I'm here right now, you know, so try my best to get in the studio as much as possible. There are times where I'm not as productive as I want to be, but I don't beat myself up about it. Again, I'm not in a place where I'm competing, you know, with anyone, or I'm not competing with the entertainment age. And I'm not in that world of competition, you know? So I'd say I'm pretty free spirited, but I definitely do work hard. I definitely do try to put in the hours that are necessary, as it would take anyone to come up with something great, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Awesome.
I love and respect that response, man, because as a creator myself, sometimes you can internalize a lot of things, and you want to be able to create from the right place. And I feel like some of your greatest work comes from you being in great mental health. At least that's how it has been for me. So salute to you for that. Salute to you.
For sure.
Go ahead, LC. You
had a question. Oh, no.
I was going to say, so how, like, we got introduced to K-pop about a year ago.
Right.
And, you know, I'm just now starting to get familiar with some of the people behind the scenes in K-pop. And, you know, there's a lot of talent in K-pop, but as well as producing and, you know, behind the writing and composing of K-pop.
Right.
How were you introduced to that?
Well, during my period of, you know, forming my songwriting duo with my partner, Dimitri, one of the things that we sought to do was just do things that were different, do things that were outside of the box. You know, we never wanted to just go after the mainstream stuff like Rihanna, Drake, Chris Brown, whatever, you know, the main artists. We've always, and because we're so dynamic, I'm a kid from Barbados with that Caribbean influence. He's a guy from Toronto that brings another element. And when we came together, we just found it so much better when we would do things that were completely different. Hence why we ended up doing a lot of European stuff. So K-pop was like that lane at the time that not a lot of guys that we knew were into it until we got introduced to the game and then realized it's a whole nother world. And one of the things that I really loved about K-pop when I started to get involved was the revere towards musicality, you know, the revere toward, you know, those bridges and those background vocals, the things that we long for in mainstream music, they're willing to still kind of do it. And there's this sense of freedom, you know, you listen to K-pop, you see there's so many different parts and there's so many different things happening. It kind of takes out of the restrictive zone of just trying to write a great hook or just trying to make something silly, you know? Yeah. So that was one of the things that really intrigued us about K-pop and, you know, gave me a sense of freedom, like I said, to do things that were different or that were not the norm in mainstream music.
Yeah. I've actually got two really good questions from the YouTube live. I'm sorry if I mispronounce your name. It's G Langal, I think. And they're asking, what new creative challenges do you face when writing for others than yourself? Is there a different switch? So is it like different writing, you know, your own music versus writing it with the mindset of, you know, NCT is going to be on it or Shiny is going to be on it? How does that work for you?
So the challenge really is, I have always found with trying to hit the target, you'd never hit it, you know, especially because with K-pop, you never know what these guys want. You know, you never know where by the time you've gotten a brief, you know, 10 other people have gotten it. And, you know, some, you know, 5 of the 10 have already hit the mark. They're not looking for that anymore. So my main challenge is not focusing too much on, you know, like the references. You know, you try your best to be within the, you know, the general area, but you really just want to, again, my goal is always to go into, okay, so what am I going to bring to the table? You know, what do I have to offer? What is it that NCT is doing or, you know, whatever other band is doing that they've never heard? You know, how can I bring that to the table? So I would say that's the biggest challenge, you know, and not getting too caught up in the zone of trying to hit the target, because that's when you miss.
Okay, good answer.
That's personal, you know. I don't know if there's any rule or law, but that's just how I feel.
Yeah. Okay.
I got another question. I got a question from the Twitch chat about your songwriting process. Do you write the lyrics first and put it to music, or do you hear a track that inspires the lyrics?
Ooh, good one.
I like that one, you know. Do I write the lyrics first? Sometimes I would. So what I find myself doing recently, I get a lot of tracks. And most of the time when the track already has a title, I'll try to write whatever song I'm doing to the title that's already there. Mm-hmm. I found that to be good because I'm like, okay, I'm respecting the place the producer might have been at when he created the beat, you know? And, you know, it always kind of takes me in the right direction. I don't typically just come up with melodies without having a track, or because I also play a musical instrument. I play the keys and stuff like that. So it's easy for me to get in the studio and maybe have some assistance, accompaniment with a keyboard or something like that, and come up with something. But if I'm writing to a track, I don't even write. I usually just come right on this mic right here. And the first thing that comes out, I just let it rip.
Nice. I like that. I like that. I watched a documentary in like 2010, maybe, of Lil Wayne. And like, he was on tour and he was just getting music done. I can't even say writing music, because he would just hear a beat and not write anything down and just punch in until he had a whole song. And I was like, yo, this guy is a genius. Even though he was kind of...
These guys have figured it out, man. Mm-hmm. I think they've figured out the formula. I feel like as soon as it goes from here to here, you lose a lot of it, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
Kind of like ground coffee. As soon as you grind the coffee, it loses its touch.
Hey, that's a nice metaphor.
That is. So I think you had messaged me on Instagram before I even knew who you were. It was actually from the NCT 127 song Focus. Is that right? So did you happen to just stumble upon our reaction, or is that something you look for the songs that you're involved in? Like, do you just search, you know, people reacting to it, or how did you actually find us?
So I saw the interview that you guys did with Droid. So I watched it and I was like, yeah, these guys are, you know, I felt encouraged that you guys were bigging up my song. Mm-hmm. So, yeah. You know, I just sent you the message based off of that. I appreciate genuine reactions to anything that I'm a part of. So nice. That was really the motivation for me reaching out to you, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Tell me about that process of that song. How did you link up with Droid, one? And then two, when you heard that instrumental, give me your process on laying the vocals down.
Yeah, so Droid and I have been working together, but by the way, we've never met. I think that's the most encouraging and the most unusual part of the whole thing. You know, Droid and I have never met yet. We've been working on records for, you know, since 2015, 2016.
Nice.
I started doing K-pop. He was actually one of the first producers that we had connected via his manager, who I connected with my then manager and kind of put their boys together, you know, and that's how we started to work. And I would say Focus, AKA Chill. I know it is Chill.
Yeah.
Focus. The process behind that record would have been just like most of the records that we did together. He would send me the track. You know, I tried to get the vibe of the track. The track was not named Chill. I don't think so. I think that was just the concept that I had in my mind.
Yeah.
I like to just, so you were asking me just the second part of your question.
When you heard the song, just walk me through like you listening to it and then your process of having a finished product that you send back to Droid, or, you know, the process of how you guys get it back to the label.
Right. Yeah. So the beat that I would have gotten was probably the version that just, like, he may have probably just did it. So it probably didn't have all of the other elements that we now hear, but definitely the basic. I think he told you guys about how he, you know, started the beat. So I would have heard all of those elements with the chords. My first reaction to the track actually was like, okay, how am I going to unlearn all of the mainstream stuff that I now know? Because obviously with the chord structure and stuff like that, it's not usual for all of those movements to happen in mainstream music. It's kind of, it's kind of like a classic approach. Mm-hmm. So I had to kind of go back, okay, how am I going to approach this? And I remember being like, yo, okay, if I can nail something on this track, it'll be pretty dope. But the first thing that stood out to me was the movement of the chords. Yeah. And again, just as I was saying, trying not to hit the target, I just had to go with however the music was taking me, you know? So my process, I think I sent him, my first draft was really probably most of what you guys would have heard on the demo or most of what you guys would have heard on the actual song. And again, my process, I just went on the mic and started spitting, you know. If there was a particular section that I felt needed to come off a little different, I'll just loop it over until I get the right feel. I really just go based on how it makes me feel. You know, I trust my relationship with music enough that I'll just do it until it makes me feel like that's what should be there. And, you know, I guess maybe about an hour later, I sent in the record and he went crazy.
I did too when I first heard it. I said, yeah, man, how did y'all just not put the English version out? But I mean,
you know, and what's the craziest thing? I always get nervous when I hear other people do renditions to my song, especially when I'm not there to like guide the session or, you know, I'm such a, I can be a little hands-on sometimes because I want whoever does the record or whoever hears the record to have the same experience I might have had when I made it. So I was super impressed to hear that NCT, not that I didn't think that they could do it, but, you know, just personally, I was so grateful that they were able to nail that record.
Yeah. Like,
you know, they took it where it needed to go.
Yeah, you just answered my next question. Like, you hearing them for the first time, man, I love that. Because when I heard you hit the high note on the demo version, I'm like, ooh, okay, Do Young got that inspiration from Jaicko. Yeah.
Hey, that is crazy.
Nice, man.
So that's one of the most fulfilling, that was probably one of the most fulfilling experience for me. Experiences, crazy story. I didn't know the song was on the album maybe a month after it actually released, or some crazy time like that. I think it came out, the record came out on September 17th.
Yeah.
No, so I knew it came out, maybe like a few days before it actually released. But so I was seeing all of this hype for NCT, and, you know, my publisher had contacted me, you know, just, you know, to approve the splits and stuff like that. We got the splits and everything for the record. But, you know, being involved in music for so long, it's never over until it's over, you know. So you take everything with a grain of salt. People tell you, oh, Bon Jovi is going to record your song. You kind of just be like, okay, cool. When I hear it happen is then when it's going to get me to move. Mm-hmm. So I, you know, we had agreed on the splits and, you know, all of the behind the scenes stuff that happened before song actually comes out. And then I'm seeing all this hype for NCT. Oh, they pre-sold this amount of million and blah, blah, blah. And I'm like, okay, that's great. So I looked at the track listing and I was looking for Chill and I didn't see it on the thing. So I was like, oh, well, I guess, you know, just another day in the life of a songwriter. And then Droid's manager hit me up like maybe the next day. It was like, yo, and sent me, I was like, I didn't write a song called Focus. And then when I played it, I was like, oh, snap.
Yeah, that was dope
moment.
What's crazy is how many people in the Twitch chat legitimately say that that's their favorite song on the album. And I mean, these are names that have been rocking with us our entire journey, some of them.
I can't see what's happening on Twitch right now, but you need to tell these people to run the bag up.
Yes.
Keep streaming it.
I personally am. I play that every time it comes on. Like, I never skip it. I'm like, oh, no. Yeah. I got to get my guys.
Well, I hear a lot of people saying that it's one of their favorite songs on the album. I appreciate that a lot.
Yeah.
Nice, man. Did you get a chance to check out their, like, entire album?
yo, the entire album is crazy. I can't understand a word they're saying.
Yeah.
The album is crazy. And mm-hmm. what's most humbling for me is that I look and I see some of the credits, you know, some of the guys that have produced on the album, guys like Harvey Mason Jr., who mm-hmm. is like one of my favorite producers of all time. On the repackage, you have guys like Dark Child producing the first single.
Yep.
And I'm like, yeah, man.
Called amongst these names, you know, is something that's been a you know, milestone for me personally in my career as a songwriter. You know?
Yeah.
Yeah, man. Huge heavy hitters on that album. When I saw that Dark Child had produced Favorite, I'm like, no wonder I'm dancing so hard to this, man. This dude's been doing it since Destiny's Child, man. And he's that's crazy. Outside of NCT, you've worked with some other K-pop artists as well, correct?
Yeah.
Yeah, just tell us a little bit about those, you know, opportunities and, you know, anything that we, because we probably have, I mean, I'm sure we've covered some of these artists that you work with, mm-hmm. but right. let us know, man, a little bit about those.
I worked on Shinee's album, Key from Shinee. I worked on his album. I worked on Bad Love.
Yeah.
I worked on the last song on that album called 18.
Yeah.
End of the world. Well, it's called End of the World, but they named it End of My World.
Yeah.
And then I worked on another group. I can't remember their name, but I wrote a song called Slingshot for them. Let me see if I can pull it up right now.
Yeah. We did a reaction to Keys. I think it was.
You guys dig that?
I don't think we did 18.
Not the album. We haven't heard that single yet, but we definitely will.
Oh yeah.
Right.
But his like single that he released, I think it was Bad Love or something.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so Bad Love was a single off of the name of the album is Bad Love and the name of the single is also Bad Love.
Yeah, man. Yeah.
Yeah, those are actually my two major K-pop breakthroughs. I mean, I would say that end of last year was my breakthrough year, I would say, in regards to K-pop, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, man.
Big ones, and I, God willing,
we'll
have some more. You know,
I'm sure you will.
Yeah, man. Are you like? Is there anybody in K-pop? Have you got a chance to check out some of these groups? Is there anybody that you might be motivated to work with?
Obviously, you know, BTS is a big one.
Yeah,
I'd love to do some more stuff with NCT. Yeah, because they're getting some really good traction right now. But I'll be honest with you, when I made Chill, that was actually during a period where I had said I wasn't gonna do any more K-pop, you know, because I had been on a journey with the Lord, I'd been on a spiritual journey. I gave my life to Christ in 2014, and mm-hmm. ever since it had, you know, my musical journey and my life's journey has kind of been a lot of wrestling, you know, kind of figuring out where my place was in music and in life. So when I made Chill, I actually made it in 2019, which would have been 2 years ago. Mm-hmm. So after that, I said, okay, I'm going to focus on my project. I'm going to focus on kind of like what you said, you know, you want to make sure that what you're talking about is real. You want to make sure that what you're saying is true to you. So I really wanted to focus on stuff that was true to me. You know, and I wanted to tell my testimony. And yeah. It was only till maybe 2 years after that the last song that I did for K-pop before I said I wasn't going to do any more records ended up being the biggest one that I've ever did, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's crazy. And when we heard the song, I really left that interview with Droid like, man, it's really artists out here making extremely high quality music that I know and love, and it's being expressed through K-pop. And a little bit of me was kind of jealous because I'm like, if this was mainstream, if this was in America, like this, he would be my number one artist, like right now, like, you know, because it's hard to find. Like,
so man, RizzleMinded is out right now, man.
Oh, exactly. I rock with it. I need, you know. And honestly, man, like I went through a lot of spiritual changes in over the past few years, you know, finding myself and everything in my place. And it really pushes me away from, like, the more I get deeper into, like, you know, spirituality and mental health, it's like the further I get away from, like, mainstream American music. And it's like, I love it. You know, I grew up listening to it. I love music. I'll never stop listening. But I'm like, it's like a craving for substance out here. And I feel like it's not just me, but it's probably like literally millions of people.
Yeah.
So, you know, so that's why I, you know, really respect your craft.
Yeah. And I second that, man. I was even nervous about starting this journey, not even knowing what K-pop was, because I, you know, I gave my life to the Lord too. I think it was like 2017, 2016. And I wanted to be very careful of what I was exposing myself to. And when I didn't know what they were saying, I was like, I would just be praying on here, like, Lord, like, please don't let me be, you know, step into something that I don't need to be involved in. So I know exactly where you're coming from, man. But I want to give you a special shout out, too, because I was on YouTube, man. And I don't have the title up here, but you were cutting loose on a worship song, bruh.
Yeah. Was it Oceans? It might have been Oceans.
It was your last YouTube update. I went to your page. I think it was 8 months ago.
Oh, yeah, so that was a song that I wrote called Your Will Be Done.
Your Will Be Done, that's the one. Yeah. I felt the Holy Spirit come up in this studio. I said, okay, Jaicko.
that's really the goal, man. I'm trying to make stuff that makes you feel what you're supposed to feel, you know?
Amen, man. Well, I fully support that, man, and thanks for sharing your testimony and your story, because I feel like, you know, you're called to, you know, minister to a lot of people through your music, man. So I'll definitely keep you in my thoughts and prayers and just keep doing what you do. Yeah.
Don't be selfish with your prayers, man. I need all the prayers.
Oh, me too. Me too.
For sure. So what's the music scene like in Barbados, man? It's a very small place. So are there like some real notable artists there where you're from, or?
For sure. I would say, you know, we are a small island. Relatively so, 166 square miles. However, we're very aware, you know, we've always been very aware of world culture as it relates to music, and we've always had stuff to offer. So musically, we've always been able to tap in to markets around the Caribbean, but then also tap into what's happening in the rest of the world. So we do have a few really great artists here. Obviously, you know, I don't know if you guys, I'll just start from maybe a decade or two ago and come up. We have guys like Rupee. You guys may or may not know that name. Pray You Do, good guy, good friend of mine, solid dude, makes great music, has a great voice. Then there's Chantel, we have Chantel Lane. We have 2 Mile Hill. We have, for you guys in Twitch and stuff like that, you guys can Google all these names. We have Tef Hinkson. We have Chris Irie. Mm-hmm. Man, there's so many names that I can call. I guess you just have to type in Barbados artists. You know, then we have some guys that I work with, a guy by the name of King Servant. He's an artist that him and I are working on a project together right now. Philip K is another artist that I'm working with. I can go on and on. You'll have to stop.
No, man, that's nice. I hope it inspires people to check these artists out.
Oh, absolutely.
And get hip to music. You know, our channel is more than, you know, just K-pop. You know, my guy here is an artist himself too.
That's right.
And songwriter as well. So, you know, we're just building a community of people who love music and good vibes.
Marks. I like it. I feel it.
Yeah. Man.
So what's next for Jaicko Lawrence?
That's exactly what I was going to ask.
Oh, man. What's next? I think, you know, let me think of what's next is to stick to what got me here. And that's trusting the Lord, being obedient to the Lord. As I mentioned, you know, what would be the odds of having one of the biggest records or being a part of one of the biggest K-pop releases for, you know, the last year after giving it all up, or after coming to a place where you said you're not going to do it anymore.
Mm.
I feel like that is the posture that has gotten me where I am. That's the reason why we're talking, yeah, right? So yeah. That's the proof in the pudding for me. You know, that's the reason why you guys would have been able to hear, you know, my testimony and hear Rizzle Minded. So overall, bros, what's next is to just continue to trust and believe the Lord, you know, believe that he is the one that is in control of my journey. I'll continue to do the best I can to meet him where he wants me to be. But I'm just going to continue to follow that path, you know, and stay on the narrow path, you know.
Amen. It sounds like you got that focus, if you know what I'm talking about. No pun there.
I see what you're trying to do.
Yeah, he's focused, y'all.
Nice.
Yeah.
So you do you play that bass in the background or what?
No, that's actually my dad's bass.
Oh, okay. Okay. I
put it there so it looks, you know.
Yeah.
Like some musical things are happening.
Yeah. I like it. I like the addition to the room, man. I've been dabbling with guitar for like years. So
okay, me too. I've been dabbling. My cousin is a phenomenal guitar player as well.
Yeah. So my question, are you open to work with other like songwriters? And could you give a songwriter some type of advice if somebody's like on the come up and they want to be a Jaicko Lawrence?
Oh yeah. I want to be a Jaicko Lawrence.
Listen, absolutely, I am always working to collaboration. I feel like we live in a time of collaboration. You know, I feel like we've realized that we're all better together than we are apart, you know? So absolutely, I am 100% open to working with anyone, you know? Advice, where do you want me to start? I always like to talk about, you know, there's this story, I might be paraphrasing a little bit, but there's this story of the guy that discovered peanut butter. You know, I don't know if you ever heard of this story, but the story I heard, you guys can Google it and fact check me. But the version of this story, it reckoned with me, you know. He held the peanut up to the sky and he prayed and asked God to give him as many ideas as he can have for this peanut. And that was one of the ways that peanut butter was discovered. You know, and I feel like that's the gift we have in music or songwriting. You know, there's so many opportunities, things that have never been heard, things that have never been seen, you know? So I would say really keep your gift, because it is a gift from God. You know, I would say keep it before God and begin to ask him like, yo, what should I be doing with this? And I believe he's the one that will lead you to the streams, you know, the rivers of living water. You know, he's the one that will multiply it, you know?
Yeah.
And again, these things that I've fact checked and I've proven with my own journey, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So I'd say that's number one. Number two, don't get so caught up in the hype, man. Don't get so caught up in where the tide is going or where things are moving, you know? Everybody thinks you're crazy until it actually works or until it actually happens. You know, look for the guys in your community, look for the artists in your community where you see a talent, where you see things in that you can pour into. You know, don't always look for the guy that's already doing the thing. Don't look for the guy that's already established, because there's the beauty in being part of something that needs your assistance in order to take it to the next level, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Amen. Yeah,
wise beyond your years, my friend.
All glory to Jesus.
Amen, yeah, brother. Amen.
Amen. Hey,
you got a question?
Do I got a question?
Yeah.
I think you've done a great job of just letting us know who you are.
Yeah.
And just, you know, your future plans. You've given me personal advice here. It's like you're almost ministering to me right now. Like some of the things that you're saying is exactly what I need to do. You know what I'm saying? Not go with the tide and just focus on me. And I think I had actually shared it with you in our the first time that you Instagram messaged me. I had told you my testimony about how I was putting a bunch of music online and it just, you know, wasn't the right message, and I took it all down. So I knew talking to you today would be, you know, the exact next steps that I need as an artist and a future songwriter as well. So I can't thank you enough for just spending some time with me to just give me some reassurance and wisdom on, you know, pressing into the Lord and, you know, just letting him guide me with my gift. Like you said, it is a gift. So I just want to say thanks.
And I appreciate, you know, just iron sharpen iron, you know, with mm-hmm. a lot that I've learned from you guys as well. You know, just talking and the little bit that we've talked, I'm sure there's more, you know, to come out of this conversation. You know, I'm grateful to have met you guys both. And, you know, you just never know how things start and where they end up, you know, so.
Absolutely,
I'm just as expectant as you are.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, for sure. So if we just happen to be in your neighborhood in Barbados, man, would you be open to link up with us and shoot some stuff?
Hey, you gotta check in.
Yeah, man, I gotta check in.
Listen, we got the food popping. You know, we got everything that you need over here, man. So just come true.
I already know, man. You know, Panama is not too far away from the Caribbean,
right?
And you know, yeah, so yeah. I got some of that Highland flavor in my system at an early age.
There you go.
So I know what I need, man. yeah. So I hope this is, you know, the conversation that's, you know, one of many,
mm-hmm.
and I hope it inspires more, you know, artists and conversations like this to happen. You know, we did that interview with Droid. And then, you know, it inspired another conversation with, you know, one of the lead people at Berklee University, which is a prestigious music school here in America. We haven't put any of that content out. We don't necessarily know how it's going to be, you know, distributed. But
so let me just give this guy Droid his flowers real quick, man. He's humble dude. Great music, like every track he sends me, like I discover his musicality a little bit more. The guy is a genius musician, man.
Yeah.
Oh, absolutely, man. The way he broke down the beat and he was using phrases I wasn't familiar with, I'm like, all right, he knows his stuff. You know, this kinetic interpolation mixed with the condensation over here on the beat. I'm like, yeah, he knows what he's doing.
He literally shifted into like interview mode, sitting up a certain way, and then he kind of like hunched over and leaned into that screen. And started moving, and I said, "Oh, he's in the zone."
Yeah, man. It's a beautiful thing, man. And we're actually going to visit Droid
later this month.
Yeah, later
thinking
this
like
month.
The next week or two.
Yeah, yeah, we're gonna link up with him.
No, is it crazy that I've never met this guy in person? Isn't it not crazy?
That's wild.
That's wild, but that's the beauty. That's the beauty in today's, you know, world we live in, because this opportunity might not have been available for us, you know, 10, 20 years ago.
Nope.
And the fact that you can produce with people from across the world is mind blowing. And then send it to somebody else on the complete other side of the world, and then they tear it up and go global with it.
And it becomes successful, right?
I mean, yeah. That's yeah. Yeah. Man. Plug yourself, man, before we wrap this interview up, man. What do they need to be checking out from you? Where can they find you? I'm gonna tell everybody personally.
Oh yeah.
To go check out. It's a song that I wrote for my
future girlfriend. Yeah,
man. That's my jam. I play that in my whip, and I almost blew my speakers out. You know, I turned the bass up. I let
bad.
The vocals ride.
My bad.
Yeah, man. I was feeling.
Yeah, so just you said plug myself, so I'll take the opportunity to just let everybody know that that entire project was written, produced, recorded by myself. I mixed it, all of it by myself. I got it mastered. Big shouts out to my boy, the LX. He helped me out with the mastering. But that was, like I said, that was one of those projects that I don't want no help. It's just me and God. And I'm going to figure it out, you know, and, you know, little by little, I got everything sounded the way I wanted to sound. So when I hear things like that, like, yo, the 808, that makes me feel really good, you know?
Yeah.
So, you know, segue into, you know, just in case you don't know what we're talking about and you're not tuning in, you know, we're talking about my, you know, should I say debut EP? No, I should probably say my first release as an artist in about 7 years. Rizzle Minded, that's RIZZLE. Minded, MINDED, and it's available. You can stream it on any platform, Spotify, Tidal, Apple Music, Amazon, wherever you stream music. You guys are not sponsored by anyone yet, right? So I didn't.
Not yet.
To make that happen. So if it's any of one of those ones that we just called in the future, you'll only use one.
Right? For sure.
But yeah, make sure you go stream that. I'd appreciate you guys just listening to it. I actually think at some point I'm just going to give it for free because, again, I just want people to hear it. You know, those responses and just being able to share it with people. You could follow me on Instagram, Jaicko Lawrence, and I'm the same name across all social platforms. Stay updated to what I'm doing, what I got going on. And, you know, I appreciate you guys on Twitch that are meeting me for the first time, people that are just getting to see the face behind the, I'm pretty sure you guys have followers that have heard the records or the record. So I'm grateful to connect with all of you guys in Twitch and on YouTube. So yeah, I hope that is sufficient.
Yeah, man.
I just want to thank you for your time and humbleness to, you know, speak with us. You know, you could have easily been like, man, I don't want to talk to these peasants. I'm a boss out here.
Right.
Nah, I'm just kidding.
Just like with Droid, when I got the message, I get so many DMs on Instagram. Like, sometimes I'll read stuff. Sometimes I'll kind of skim it. But I got your message, and then I was like,
Who's this guy talking about?
No, I think the first message you said, it was something like, hey, man, thanks, and I appreciate, you know, your reaction, da-da-da. So I, like, read it, and I closed my phone. And something told me to just open it up and look at your profile. And I'm like, hold on. And then this next message I had asked you, I was like, were you one of the writers? And you were like, oh, yeah, my bad. I'm Jaicko. And I was like, bruh, what? This journey has just been amazing, man. Like, I never expected any of this to ever happen. You know what I'm saying? I believed it, but I just didn't expect it, especially this quick. Just from sitting down one day in the position we were in, and we literally just, hey, got on camera and kept going.
So
and look where we're at.
How long have you guys been doing this whole thing? How long have you guys been in it?
It'll be a year, January 11th. So just to give you a quick story, like, we didn't plan on any of this. We were just going to have him do film and video work and me be an artist, and then we had two other guys with us. They quit, and then me and him were just scrambling, man. We were trying to run a company with just two of us. Yeah. I sat down, did a reaction by myself. It was terrible. He hopped in and helped me and just happened to.
It wasn't my record.
Oh, no. The record was good. It was me that was terrible. Like, my computer wasn't powerful enough. The mouths weren't matching the words. It was. Right. I was so frustrated that just out of frustration alone, my guy couldn't leave me stranded. He was like, man, I'll at least help you, but let's listen to a K-pop song. And I'm like, nah, bro, I don't like pop music. He's like, nah, man, it's got some bang to it. Just try it. So, and here we are.
Yeah, man.
You never really know how it's going to look. You know what I'm saying?
And, you know, prior to this and even now, like, you know, my profession is like a videographer, you know, filmmaker. I shoot stuff, you know. So my aspirations is to work with people like you, you know, like, just sitting and doing YouTube reactions, like, it's fun for us, but it's like not our long-term goal, you know?
Right.
So, you know, we hope to get out here and, like, step into more of our lane of what we actually do.
Right.
Like, in real life outside of YouTube, you know, we shoot and we edit and, you know, he writes and he makes songs and, you know, we're teaching a class at a high school and everything too. So,
yep.
Our goal is to kind of bring all of this content to YouTube and our audience and build a network of people who can, you know, get inspired, learn, and connect with each other.
Right.
You know, more Droids, more Jaickos.
Yeah.
I feel, like I said, I feel really special. I'm the guy now. I wasn't always like this, but, you know, I like the underdogs, you know. I tend to be attracted to people that they have heart. And, you know, just from talking to you guys, I can tell that there's lots of substance behind what you guys are doing. Mm-hmm. And, you know, even if it's just this hour that we talk, man, I'm glad to be a part of I'm glad to be a part of your growth, you know, on September, January 11th, you said when that's the anniversary of your starting.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Congrats, man. For real.
Thank you.
I was here. I know y'all guys, man.
I know it, man.
Appreciate it, man.
All the best, man. And I pray it all forms into something, like you said, that's beyond podcasts and beyond, you know, whatever boxes they are in your world.
Yeah, man. Appreciate that, sir.
Yeah, man. Much love. Much love.
Thank you so much for your time, brother. Thank you, everybody, for tuning in live on Twitch. You know, we'll drop his information on our YouTube description. Make sure you check him out.
Stream, please do.
Stream his album till you can't stream no more. Stream it in the shower.
Yes.
Yeah.
Run it up. Run it up for my man.
And then before we get out of here, man, you got my email address. Send me that MP3, man. A chill, man.
We won't leak it, I swear.
I swear I won't leak it.
I might have to talk to the higher ups.
It's in good hands, you know what I mean? I just want it for the gym. That's all I want.
I just own the furniture in the house.
Yeah.
Okay.
Oh, man.
No, I appreciate
it. Couch, man.
Yeah. Hey, thank y'all, man. We catch you later, brother.
Yeah, we'll definitely be in touch, man. If there's anything we can do to help you, let us know.
Hey, yeah, for sure, for sure.
Likewise. I
got to
say likewise.
Yeah.
Appreciate that.
Appreciate your platform. God bless.
God bless you too, brother. Take care.
Hey. Let me hit the button. Hold on. Pause.
I'm trying to end.